Obviously long to start up TouchDesigner, don't ask me what's happening here. But we have placed, so this whole, this is basically the interface when you start up TouchDesigner, that's what you get. It's not the most exciting, perhaps. We have been contemplating on how to make this better. For now we have candy. There's a couple important parts to maybe mention first, and this is how to get help when you're inside TouchDesigner. There are these three large buttons up here. The first one, which points you to the wiki, so that's on our website. That's not loading. Oh, there it is. It's docs.derivative.ca, which is a large wiki which has information on all the operators, on the hardware that we support, protocols that we support, and as well as a full reference of the Python scripting language, at least to what relates to TouchDesigner. It's pretty much always updated, so you find the most up-to-date information on the wiki. If not, send us an email, because we try to keep it as up to date as we can, but sometimes we miss that. The other thing is our forum. We have now a pretty active user community that supports itself via the forum, and we are on the forum pretty regularly too, pretty constantly. So ask any questions there that you like. I also need to mention the Facebook group. The Facebook TouchDesigner group, and it's called TouchDesigner Help Group, I think. Now I need to know how to use Facebook Help Group. So this is that's the English Help Group, which is very active for. With a ton of members, and you find people like Richard Burns, who started it. He is using TouchDesigner in his daily work on large scale projects, but as well people like Matthew Ragan, who's one of the heaviest users, and he's one of the technical people at Obscura Digital. He's helping here share his insight, and he has a great amount of insight, and it's really great to pick his brain on any kind of questions you might have. And Luciano, you started the TouchDesigner Espanol group, right? And it's somewhere here.
TouchDesigner en Español. Así lo... en Español.
And there's already 451 members here. So Facebook is a great resource, getting help, I believe, all around, as you get fairly quick feedback as well. Form, right. Next. Well, when you deal with all these operators, we tried to kind of do the same thing what MaxMSP did, where in MaxMSP you have an operator and you can get a help patch for that operator to understand what that operator is doing. So we are not as advanced as MaxMSP at this, but in the help menu here, there's a little entry called operator snippets. And these operator snippets are basically our little help patches. So you can browse the different operators that we have created help for in the for the different families of operators, which we'll get to in a moment. And then below you have the different examples per for each node. There's a variety with a little bit of help text along. Great resource if you don't know exactly how an operator functions, then going to the snippets will give you good insight on these things. Even if you need to know how to do an LED mapping in TouchDesigner, then that can be found in here, operator snippets. And while I'm here and on the help, I might explain a little bit further, or I'll go a little bit further and then into the help. We have up here, we have our regular menu section. You see that I don't have the latest software installed right now. Usually you would see either a yellow, little yellow bar there when we have a new experimental release, or a new green button when we have a new official release. So we say, use experimental at your own risk. It usually has more bugs, and the official release usually has less bugs. We do guarantee a bug in the software, though. There's definitely a bug. On the left side here, we have a palette, and the palette is something that's probably going to change in the future, but it's tools and or little example components that are useful in daily production work. So it's a couple image filters, which are not too great, but if you look at them, you can understand how certain image effects are built. You also will find TD Ableton, a collection of components that help you to communicate or interact with Ableton, as well as various VR components, etc. And in the tools section, things for projection mapping, and it's more or less useful. There's some very useful things and some less useful, but it's kind of good for what it is. And then here in the big thing here, this is what we call a pane. This is the network pane where you put down the operators and create your networks. And you can always select the network, and you can see on the right side here in this top right corner, those are the parameters that are for the operator. So the parameters which you can change how this operator is working. And because I was talking about help, it would be worth mentioning that there's the two help buttons on it. The first help button takes you to the operator help on the wiki. So it goes straight to there, help for the movie file in top, where most of the parameters are explained in a little bit more length. And the button beside it is the Python help for this operator. So it's any Python members and methods that you can access via this operator. For the movie file intop, for example, it's about getting the length of the movie or something like that. Yeah, variety of things. And if you hit the Alt key, and now I'm not sure what it is on the Mac. Does the Mac have an Alt key?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Oh, okay, perfect. So if you hit the Alt key and you roll over the parameters, you also get a little bit of help on the parameter. So this is how basically you can get help in these things. If you don't have this parameter window on the top right, you can hit P and it toggles the parameter window. And now sometimes your parameters look different from mine. And usually that's the case when you accidentally or perhaps willingly you hit this non-default parameters only button. And this button, all it does is it hides any parameter that's not its default value. This way, because some of these operators have lots of parameters, and you want to know in a network from somebody else, you want to know what changed, what they have done to this operator, then this button can be really helpful because it hides everything else that's default, and you can see what the user has changed. So how to get around the network here? We have, it's very useful if you have a three button mouse. It's kind of the, for me, the best way to get around. Left mouse would be panning around in the network. Right mouse is selecting nodes. And the middle mouse button, especially if it's a scroll wheel, you can zoom the whole network. And the thing with these networks is that it's an infinite it's an infinite canvas. So you can go as far as you can. And then that's where it's important to know the H key. If you hit H, you get home, and it kind of frames your operators again. Maybe a good one to know as well, if you if you're totally lost and you don't know where anything is, there's the O key. And the O key brings up a little window down here, kind of giving you a sense of where nodes are placed in the network, and you can kind of move around in it as well. The O, O, yes. And so if you don't have a three-button mouse, some of the mouse pads now support zooming, like with a two-finger pinch zoom. And the other option is that, now again, control, does that exist on a Mac, or is that something else?
Sometimes there is a control key, but mostly control on a machine is command.
So it's then control or command plus and minus, where you can zoom the network as well if you have no access to a mouse. The next thing to perhaps when getting around in a network, what's important to look at is this upper navigation bar. Because networks are not necessarily just built in a flat plane. These are actually hierarchical networks. So, for example, this GO1 here is a container. So if you double click on it, or actually it's active, so you get a zoom in it or hit enter, then you can go into this component. And you know that you're inside this component because it says project 1 GO1 on the top address bar. So you have to watch out if you don't, like you suddenly end up in a different in a different place, then it's good to look at this thing here and perhaps also start naming your components in a way that you know what's going on. That's definitely a good idea.
So how do you access inside
the... Right, and getting into those things, there's multiple ways of doing that. As a general rule, there's at least three ways in TouchDesigner to do a single thing. Because we cannot agree in the company what's the best way to do it. So we So getting into this, one of the ways is if you have a three-button mouse with a scroll wheel, and this can be funny, you can basically zoom and zoom and zoom, and then you just end up in there. So you have a nice, it also fades nicely. The other way is if you have a node selected, so if you have the green border around the operator, then you can hit enter to go inside. And then how do you get out of this again? Well, you could click onto the project one here in the navigation bar here. Or you can also use keys. And there's two keys to remember there. One is U to go up a level, U like up. So for example, I'm still in project one right here. So if I hit U, I get to root, just slash. So I'm now level up. And if I had hit I for in, I go one level in. So you can also be very keyboard keyboard centric when navigating around. Yeah, keep an eye on these passes to not get too lost in the whole thing. So as I said, selecting an operator is quite simple. You can just click on it with the left mouse button. You see the parameters change. You can also select multiple with the right mouse button if you need to delete or do some common operations on them. This is probably the important thing to know here. If you click on an operator and the operator, there's a difference here that you can see. The GO1 has somehow no frame on it. Like it's a floating, or yeah, it's missing controls. While the displays has this frame around it with a couple of buttons. So when you see these icons on a node, then you can grab the node and move it around, just place it somewhere else. If that frame is missing, then what you have done is you clicked, or it was somebody else previously working on the file, clicked on this viewer active flag. And why is that important? Well, if you activate a viewer, each viewer in TouchDesigner is interactive. So here, for example, we see a 3D geometry, and you can interact with it. It's a full 3D viewer. You can zoom with the middle mouse button again, tumble with the left mouse button, and pan with the right mouse button. H brings it back. So now you cannot move the node. You still kind of can move the node by clicking on the name, where you usually rename the node, and you can move it around. So yeah, the viewer active is kind of important as it gives you access to more information of the, like you can explore interactively, explore the data in its context that it's given here. Now talking about this, you have various, in this little candy network, you have access to data in three different ways. The blue nodes here, they're called TOPS, texture operators, and they are based on pixel data, color data. So it's basically, yeah, images or animated images, movies, whatever. And you see that here, this one is a static photo loaded in by a movie file in TOP. Below it, there's something animating. And then this node here, a filter node for displays, it uses the animated to displace the static. And if I hit the viewer active flag here, I said all of them are interactive, all these viewers. What you can do here is you can really zoom into the whole thing if you need to. You can explore red, green, and blue channels separately, or the alpha. The alpha is a little bit boring with this. When you have the viewer active on the operator, then using the R, G, B, or A key, you can explore the different channels of your image. Red, green, blue, alpha.
How do you go back?
And if you want to go back, you just hit the like if you hit R again, then you're back in the color. There's also, if you right-click into the active viewer, then you get a little menu that shows you all the options for it.
That's
for the viewer. Right click. Yeah. A useful display in these things is the pixel values. If you need to know what a certain color is, then you can zoom in onto the pixel level, and you have the information for your color channels as well as the XY position of the pixel. Display pixel values.
Yeah.
Now the so that's the 2D data. The geo here is 3D data, and the difference between 3D data and 2D data essentially, or pixels and geometry, is that geometry is described in coordinates, so to say, like you have x, y, z as points or certain attributes of a geometry. And usually you have to take this data and somehow render it. So it works like a 3D software in a way, and we'll look at this later, where you have a camera and a light and a material and some geometry to take a 3D definition and convert it into pixels. So if you, yeah, you have this 3D object and you can explore it in here, but once it's rendered, then it becomes, and this is not really representative of the whole thing, but once it's rendered, it's just pixels. You cannot make changes to the 3D data then. And then we have another node here, this green one, which is a chop This is called, yeah, it's called a CHOP. It's a channel operator. And channel operators hold anything that has to deal with animation data or audio inputs, MIDI coming in, MIDI going out, anything that can be described as values, essentially. The interesting part, perhaps, is that you can convert between all of these operators. You can take an animation data and convert it into pixel data, because a red channel or a pixel is just four values. It's a red value, green value, blue value, and an alpha value. So you can describe it either with numbers or you can describe it as color. Right. And this is exactly what this kind of is supposed to illustrate here. If you, I'm just going to change something here quickly so you can see that better. Phil, I'm going to pause it here. So this annoys, generates a noise of some sort, and this is being converted into pixels. And you can see that where you are at 0.5, where the value is 0.5, it's very gray. And if it dips lower, it becomes darker. And if it becomes, if it goes higher, the value goes higher, it becomes lighter. So it's a direct translation between values and pixels. And this works in all directions. You can take image data, and like, for example, if I take this displays here and I convert it back into a CHOP. So what you see here is a single scan line. It's the center scan line by default. And you see the RGB alpha values for that single scan line there. You can take 3D data. So I'm just gonna take a circle sub that illustrates it nicely. And so this is just points in space. You see all these separate points here. If I turn on wireframes, you just have points. And if I convert this into a CHOP, I would use a sub 2. You basically see the definition of a circle. You have a cosine and a sine, and that makes a circle. So it's every point is being converted into a value. And you can take this again, and maybe I'll just monkey something up here. I'll take a noise and add it to it. This is not going to be pretty or anything special, and we'll get to how I'm just doing this all in a moment, but I can convert this again into geometry. Yeah. So you can go in circles and three times around, because some things are easier to do in a 3D realm, other things are easier to do in a channel realm, in a, like, where you have values basically. And sometimes it's easier to convert a 3D object into a CHOP, here TX, TY, then convert that into a TOP. So you have your TX, TY, TZ as RGB, and then maybe blurred or something, and then output it again as geometry. So you can go full circle. There's usage cases for all of these things that you will discover while working with it, essentially. It's kind of trying things out and exploring, and you will discover the uses of it. One thing that just bit me a second ago that's important to know is the spacebar. Touch being a real-time system means we have a timeline, but the timeline becomes less and less important because it just runs all the time anyway. You're not necessarily a timeline based. You don't need to know which frame you're on in most cases. It just keeps on running. So what often happens is that you're looking at a you're looking at something and nothing is moving, but you think, what's going on? There should be something happening here. Usually is because you hit the space bar. That's a common mistake. So something is weird, space bar. Now the space bar kind of stops the animation, but there's still certain things cooking. And there's another little button up here, which is kind of the power button. If you hit the power button, it stops everything. There's no more, just nothing is being calculated at this moment. So this is a total off state now. This button can be very useful if your whole network hangs because you accidentally put a node down that is overpowering your CPU or something like that. Then try hitting the cooking button, and you might regain control of the whole system. Because it's real time, so it tries to render at a frame rate that you set. The frame rate you can set down here, left on the left side beside the timeline. There's a little FPS parameter, so you could run things by default at 60. You can run things at 120 or 30 or whatever frame rate you choose. And TouchDesigner will try to render this amount that you give it every second. And if it cannot do that, it skips frames. So what it does is it just thinks, okay, this is taking way too long, and I'm gonna just skip the next three frames. And your frame rate drops basically. And sometimes, as I said, if you do a way heavy thing, then it drops into takes 30 seconds per frame. And that's exactly where the cooking button comes in handy, because you don't want to wait 30 seconds for each frame. You probably did something wrong at that point. Right.
You can visualize in an easy way what process is the more
most expensive?
Yeah.
Like takes the most time?
Yes.
Yeah, there's a couple ways to do this in TouchDesigner. There's one that's important for a quick look is the performance monitor, which you can find under dialogues and performance monitor.
Yeah.
And if you hit analyze on it, it will give you a fairly funny graph of what's happening in the background. Well, and in a sense, when you have when you just want to know, like, your frame rate dropped and you don't know what's happening, but you know something is happening, then you can check the first column here. Is the cooking time per operator. It tells you how many milliseconds it took for a certain operator to cook. And then you can fairly quickly identify what takes a long time, usually. The other thing, why is it this long list? Because all these operators are dependent from each other. It's a big tree. It starts with one operator, and then it trickles down, and now it has to look somewhere else, what's happening there. And so this is a little bit of visualization of in what direction this whole thing is cooking, like what is dependent on what else. Most often you just look at the milliseconds and see what has just been going wrong. One thing maybe that's interesting when you do installations and people are, you have an installation where every, I don't know, or at random times there's a frame drop. And you can see the frame drop, like there's a frame missing, then there's a frame trigger field here in the performance monitor at the bottom. So you can set a time here. If my frame takes longer than 20 milliseconds, then tell me, then spit out the list. And then I can see, oh, this took longer, and here I see what actually took that long. That's a performance monitor. That was a good question. That's important. There's an interesting in the palette under tools. There's another tool that Greg my boss built. It's called Probe. Yeah, it's in the palette under Tools. And from the palette, you can drag in, you can just drag it into your network. So it takes a little bit to load. And then it says, press Control P to turn on panel. Control P. Okay. And now you get a more visualization of your network here, where you're currently in root, and you see what takes how long, or yeah, you see like project one takes a little bit of time.
Control P in the bar.
Yeah, it should be just Control P. Or Command P.
Yeah.
And you can click on these things. And now you can look at this thing. You can basically look at Project One Probe. You can look at this project itself to see what's cooking, how much, and this is just something that's built also with TouchDesigner, obviously. There's actually a funny key that's quite useful. If you're hovering over some of these things, if you hit F10, then it takes you to that network. So you can explore the part that you're hovering over. You can look how that's actually built.
Yes.
F10. So that's another nice visual tool to explore the whole performance, actually. One more thing to mention in the interface is preferences. The preferences gives you some settings that you might be interesting right away would be right on the general page. You have, so I access that via edit preferences, or on the Mac, it's the, is it the Apple, or is it maybe a TouchDesigner menu item? Yeah, TouchDesigner preferences. And there what you get is, the first thing is very useful, the increment file name on save. Thing with TouchDesigner is when you hit Control S, or when you save your file, then it saves it with a number. So it keeps a record of all your past.
That's also about the DFS past.
Yeah, pretty much. And one of the things is that often you do something and you like it, then it's a good idea to hit Control S, because there's a good likelihood that you play around more and you lose what you just liked. So, and it's hard to go back. But when you hit Control S, you keep a history of that. And the whole thing is saved in, if you just open up TouchDesigner and then hit Control S, it saves it on your desktop by default. But yeah, you can just go file, save as, or something like that, into a separate folder, or by going create project folder, you can also create a proper project folder for what you're doing. And then this setting here in increment file name on save, especially when you have on and copy to backup folder, organizes your folder a little bit. What it does is it creates another folder called backup, and all those versions that you're saving when you hit Control S are being placed in this backup folder. So that if you look at projects like, let's quickly find one. Where are we? So if you are in a project like this, then you only see two files here. You see the project name .toe, which is always the latest file that you saved. Then there is the project file with a number, which is equal. It's the same file. Should be, but apparently it's not in this case. And then there's a backup folder, which, right, okay, yeah, because this is on a Git, so I didn't put the backups there. But usually you have, there's a backup folder here. So you have a backup folder where it puts all the old files into it. Because this being a Git, I don't sync all those files. Therefore, they're not here. But That's yeah. So this setting, it's very useful. One more setting that I should show you is on the tops page here, which is viewer background. The viewer background can be set to black or to checkerboard. Checkerboard is the default. What the checkerboard setting does is when you have alpha, when you have transparency in your image, then it shows that as a checkerboard in the background. So I'm just going to choose an image here with transparency, and there's a jellybeans.tiff. So my setting, my default setting is I want a black background. I don't like the checkerboard, so I put a black background there. But if I change it to checkerboard, this is what you see. You basically can tell that there's alpha, that there's an alpha layer or transparency in the image. So don't be confused when you see this. You can change it to black as a setting. If you would output this to a projector, then it would come out black because, well, there's no information basically in those points. So let's set that back to black for me. And yeah, maybe let's have a look at what we can build here. Oh, sorry, one more. One more preference. It's under dots. Dots is a family called data. It's missing the ops, but dot tops didn't work, so it's dots. And there's text editor and table editor. So dots is an operator where you store scripts or tabular data in, or text data. And to edit this, you can use either it uses the default editor that you have on your machine, or you can set it to Sublime or whatever you use as a code editor. Okay, so the first thing that I just to give you a little idea of how the nodes, how you can plug them together, the first thing I would like to build with you is this thing that I aptly named Site Adjuster. I'm just going to start it to show you the end result of this. And it's a fairly simple network. It's very simple, actually. We'll be able to do this easily once it starts up. And I will kind of take you through this process step by step to get you familiar with this node-based concept and a little bit of interactivity in the whole thing. There you go. All right. So this is good for bending eyesight. What it's essentially just a 2D compositing network that we'll do, and we'll animate it with the mouse. So you have to imagine that instead of a mouse, you can use any other input. You could use a Kinect, you can use a Leap Motion, Arduino, anything MIDI. Yeah, so this is the result, kind of. You see that has also a little bit of an RGB delay in it. And in the end, you can output this via... I'm mirroring my display, obviously. So, but there's an output mechanism in TouchDesigner to output this as a full screen, what basically would go out your projector in the end. So we'll look at that as well. And to do so, I'm just going to close that up again, or maybe I'll leave it open. I'll just turn it off and get started here.
If you have any projects open, performance is lower, or only it's working when you see the project?
There is a setting in the preferences as well, which I usually turn off cooking on if I have a project that I just want to stow, that I want to look at, but I don't want it to impact my performance, and I usually turn cooking off. But there's a preference where when you hit minimize, then that it stops cooking by itself. So it should be fine to have multiples. Now, if it's heavy in texture memory, like every top, as all of these tops are being calculated on the GPU, on your graphics card, they take up certain memory on your graphics card, meaning if you have lots of files open, you might drain your graphics memory.
Okay. So, the
real-time
flag.
Yeah. This is a flag which, if you have real-time on, what Touch does, it will render, it will take 1 second to go ahead 1 second on your timeline. So it will try to render 60 frames. If it cannot render 60 frames in 1 second, it's going to skip frames. If you turn the real-time flag off, and this is important when rendering out movies and stuff, then it's going to calculate every single frame and make sure that it's being rendered. Okay, so when you, everybody should kind of see what I'm seeing, probably minus this and something like that. Anyway, so let's remove all these nodes. If you want to remove all those nodes, you can just use the right mouse button to select them all and hit delete to clean up the pane. Control Z or Command Z, I guess, brings it all back. You can also, to select all nodes, you can also hit Command or Control A. Everything would be selected and you can delete it. Good. Now, let's create our first node. It's a fairly simple process by hitting Tab. So if you hit Tab, you get this upgrade dialog with a bunch of, if you keep hitting Tab, then it circles through all the different families. And there we have comps, which is components. Those are generally, you can think of as networks. So there's more nodes usually inside. They're distinguished between 3D objects. So anything that has to do with 3D, cameras, lights, geometry itself. There's panels for UI building. Because TouchDesigner can be used to build UIs. In fact, if you, this whole UI is actually built with TouchDesigner itself. So if you want to explore how this upgrade dialog is built, you can hover over it and hit F10. And hit F10. No. Okay, not the upgrade dialog. if you just roll over somewhere else and hit F10, it basically takes you to the network that builds the which section? Here, pane layout. So this thing. So this is the network that builds the pane layout. The bookmark bar here. And if I go, here's the menu up. This is the upgrade dialog. You can see here's the upgrade dialog. And it's made out of all these parts here. So you can keep exploring.
This is the software.
That's the software, yeah.
You disconnect something.
Yeah. You have to restart. That's the game. So that's the tab menu and the panel components here. And then the third is kind of other, which deals with animation. There's an animation editor or animation components in there to do keyframing and things like that, as well as other things we probably won't touch on, like the replicator, but we will have a look at the window component, which is the component you need to output to the projector or to many projectors. The next family here is tops, and that's kind of what we'll be focusing on, tops and chops now. Tops, as I said, is texture operators. And texture operators deal with pixels. So if you look at in here a little bit, you have things like connect. So if you have a connect and you put down the connect node, then that's what will bring in the connect images, the different the RGB camera image or the infrared or the point cloud as color data. Or as a simple example here, if I click, for example, video device in, then this would be the camera, access to the camera. And you have a wide array of libraries and devices that we support here. So Yeah, this is TOPS basically. And the other family we'll be looking at a little bit with this project is CHOPS. As I said, those are the channel operators, which deal with values in a sense, or animation data. Now, one thing to perhaps say about the upgrade dialog is you have a little search bar up here, and it's a very primitive search bar. It only searches the name. So if you type in, if you need to find the movie file in or something like that, then if you keep typing here, it's going to highlight those operators for you. The other thing is that you see that there's light nodes and dark nodes. And the difference between those two is the dark nodes are something we refer to as generators. So they create an image, like the movie file in just makes an image.
The dark ones.
The video device in creates an image. The noise creates an image already. While the light nodes are filters. And the filters are where you change images. So the easiest ones to look at would be the level top. The level top where you can change levels, contrast, black levels. There's the HSV adjust, which lets you change color itself by a hue saturation, and etc. Like there's a bunch. And let's start with a generator here. So try to find the circle top. The circle top. And the circle top, yeah, and then you just click on it, and you should have this little frame on your mouse. And now you can zoom or place it somewhere in your network by clicking somewhere in the network, and that's where it will create the circle top. And then you get a bunch of parameters here. Where you can describe this circle top. You have a radius where you can type in a radius in two directions. So if I do 0.6, for example, it's going to be an oval. You have, well, rotate. Yeah, I guess that makes sense. And rotate the whole thing. Center position, etc. Color settings. All the things that you can do with a circle top, essentially. There's a softness page. You can switch between parameter pages. Sometimes we invent new pages because otherwise the list gets too long. So we split functionality out onto new pages. And then there's a comment page. And you will find this comment page on a lot of operators. Depending on the family you're on, it will have different parameters that you can find on every operator of that family. So common operators for TOPS would be resolution, for example, where you set resolution of this operator here. Right now, by default, it's 256 by 256, but we can change this to 1280 by 720 by either typing it in, or you have this little drop-down menu here at the end. So if there's an arrow at the end of parameters, you have little drop-down menus that have some preset parameters, so you can quickly switch this up to 1280 by 720. So let's do that on the comment page resolution, 1280 by 720. And
you must have all your images in the same resolution?
So the way it works is that you don't have to have them at the same resolution. Usually it is that your generators set the resolution for your chain. But so the next, if I put something on here, let's say I'll put an edge filter, then this edge filter will have a resolution of 1280 by 720. And you can see what resolution, like it's not apparent what resolution this has, but if you hit the middle mouse button on it, actually, you get information about this operator itself. Like you get, here it says size, you have the resolution there. But now you might not want this to be 1280 by 720. So you can go again to the comment page. And while it says here, use input, you can change this to custom resolution. Or you can do like ratios of it, etc. Oh, yeah.
Right. So I didn't. I went. I'll get to that in a second. Yeah. So once we have the resolution set here, 1280 by 720, let's go back onto the circle page of this parameter, of this circle parameter thing. And just to look at this radius again, I'm going to type 0.4 by 0.4. There is some of these parameters here have yet again another little submenu here, which is when you click on what's now an A, it gives you the possibility to define this radius in various ways. You can define it as an aspect ratio, you can define it as pixel size, or you can define it as a fraction aspect, which is this here. I have to say, I actually don't know what the difference between fraction and fraction aspect is. But you can try that out and then you know what it is. So setting it to pixels, for example, you have 512 by 512 here by default. So you can type in numbers for these parameters, but what you also can do is you can use something that's called a value ladder to change those parameters. And this value ladder is being activated by either middle mouse clicking on a parameter or left mouse button clicking and then holding down. And up pops this little value ladder here. And what this value ladder lets you do, if you keep the mouse button clicked and you choose the value, the increment value. So you can increment this by one pixel if you move left or right, or you can increment by 10, or you can go by smaller values as well, which I guess with pixels doesn't make much sense, but you can do that certainly. Yeah, and all these parameters can be controlled by anything else. Yeah.
And you can choose.
And we'll do that in a second too.
Yeah.
No, it's good.
Left or right?
So when you set the value, and you change it, you pass 10 by 10, or 1 by 1, 0 by 1.
Yeah, so you hold, you move your mouse cursor. You move your, it's a little bit of a funny concept, but. Yeah, then you go left, and once you have chosen your, once you're hovering over it, you can do that. And, I did this now by clicking onto the radius, onto the name of the parameter. And it's controlling both parameters at once. But you can also click onto each parameter separately and do this. So it's a quick way of trying out. Like if you need to type in those numbers, it's kind of painful and you don't know what's happening. If you use the value ladder, you can quickly dial it in.
And change in real time.
And changes, yeah, all changes in real time. So just to demonstrate the rotate, which is another thing here, you have, this is a different kind of parameter where you have a little slider that you can move to quickly adjust that. Now these sliders, they might seem like they only go from zero to their upper range, lower range to upper range, but most of these values can be overdriven. So while the range of the slider is 0 to 360, nothing stops you from typing minus 125 or using the value ladder again to just do any value you like. So those, a lot of these parameters can be overdriven. You're not limited to this range. It's just a range where we think, okay, that's most useful. All right, so let's set the radius to something. If you have changed the resolution of your of this circle top to 1280 by 720, let's change the radius to something like, let's say 500 by 500. that's way too big. Oh, it's the radius, obviously. That's not diameter. Let's say 250 by 250. Okay, and we've got a circle. Now the circle can also be controlled in a way that you can set its start angle and end angle. So you can open up this to a pi, essentially. So you have down at the bottom, you have arc angles. I want to say archangels, but no, it's angles. And by changing those, you see that you can basically create these kind of little, pie things. And another thing you can do also with this circle is you can make it not a circle, but you can make it a polygon where you define how many sides it should have. So if you turn on polygon on the polygon parameter, now you have access to the sides where, you can have like three sides only or something like that. So let's set this, arc angle. Jesus. And then I said, never mind. English is not my first language, but I swear a lot in English. I don't do this in German. It's ridiculous. So let's turn off polygon, actually, so that we have a circle. And let's set the first angle parameter to 120. And then let's just copy this circle. So, copy and paste. You will see sometimes that the node size changes on you. Essentially, what it does, it tries to fit the node to the aspect of the viewer. You can also change this in preferences that you always keep it at a constant aspect ratio. It's a preference. And what we can do here is we could set, for example, the we want the one circle. If we just look back at the finished product here, we basically would want one circle to be the opposite of the other circle. And to do this, you literally just set the opposite sides of the angles, right? One controls the end angle, the other one controls the starting angle. And we can do this here. Like here we set it 120 the start. Here we can set the start to 0 and the end to 120. So you have. And now we would like to control those. We want to hook this up to the mouse. So let's bring in hit tab again to open up the upgrade dialog. And for these controlling values, we cannot, that's not in the top family because tops are pixels. This is in the chop family because chop is animation data and any kind of control signals, etc. And I said I want to get the mouse values. So let's have a look for the mouse chop. And there's a mouse in and a mouse out. The mouse out is weird because it basically moves your mouse. I honestly have no clue why we have that. But it's there. It's not for recording it, it's for controlling your mouse movement.
Yeah, but you have to, like, mouse out to make the movement.
Oh, yeah, you can. Okay, this is. Let's see.
To print and send some. I don't know. To make a.
Control stuff we are trying to build with a mouse out, so it moves by itself.
Yeah. 1, 2, 2. Let's see what this is doing. You can basically. All right, I gotta name it. You don't have to follow me here. This is just for fun and giggles. Yeah, well, So now my mouse is unfortunately.
Is there a shortcut?
No, it was the mouse out. Yeah, so I hit the play bar, the space bar, to stop it. Yeah. But so yeah, you can control the mouse. You have control over left, right, middle mouse button. let me delete this. What we want is the mouse in. So the mouse out is for playing tricks on your coworkers. And the mouse in, what it gives you is, you basically, if you look at the parameters of the mouse in, you can tell it what these channels, those are called channels here, and you can tell it what they should be named. So TX, TY, is there just the name of those channels? If I call it TX1, it will be TX1. You can get left, right, middle mouse button, the wheel, etc. And you can specify the monitor on which you want the mouse coordinates with, because if you have multiple monitors, now the whole coordinate system might be offset, certainly. So you can specify also the monitor by index. 0, 1, 2, on which to get this from. And you can get those mouse coordinates in various different value ranges. So there would be absolute for pixels from left to right, bottom to top, or normalized, which would be 0 to 1. Sorry, no, that's not true. It's actually the center of your screen is 0. So the left side is -1, the right side +1, and the bottom -1, the top +1. And let's use those normalized values, because when we have normalized values, it's easy to adapt to any screen resolution. It's a simple, it's a nice, nice way of working. And what I would want to do is I want to control these angles here with those mouse coordinates. So I have to somehow massage this data to be not from -1 to 1, but to be from 0 to 360, or -360 to 360. And a good operator to do this with is the mask chop. So how do we add an operator onto this operator so that we can process the data? And this would be by right-clicking onto the output of this operator. So you see that this operator, as it is a generator, it usually doesn't have an input. There's no input to it, but it's got an output. And if you right-click onto the output, it opens up the upgrade dialog. And you can find the math job. Math. Which again is a module with lots and lots of functions, where on the multi-add page, for example, you could multiply these values by a certain value, or subtract, post-add, or for our use here, the range page is of interest, because here you can rearrange your values easily. From range, our input range is -1 to +1. So in the first row in the from range, type -1 to 1. And now the to range would be, what do you want this input range to be outputted as? And this could be, for example, -360 to 360. It's basically a scale. You could literally also do x360 on the multiply. The nice thing, and why I'm mentioning the range, is that you can do weird things, like you could do it 128 to 256 or something like that. So it's an easy way of skipping a lot of math. Okay, so we have our two channels. And let's move those two channels onto those parameters finally. And to do this, we are using something that's called exporting. And the first step for exporting, and this is just a style thing or something that is very recommended, is adding a null chop So you want to add onto the output of the math one. So you can right mouse button click on the output of the math one and find the null job. And place it there. So now the null job doesn't do much. The null job has some functionality that we would like to be gone. The functionality that's actually in the math job is to there are certain bugs in the software that you can fix with the null job. So it's basically just there, but by default there's nothing there. When you need it? Yeah, so I mean, if you run into one of those bugs, then you will know about it from the forum or Facebook. People will tell you to turn on, like, change the cook type to always or selective. And it has something to do with performance or values not updating and stuff like that. It's very rare. It's very, very rare that you would use this, but it comes in very handy in certain situations. But we highly discourage this whole thing. And the null job, though, what we try to do with the null job is we try to end chains, essentially. So you have a process chain where you do some data and you come to the end. You don't want to manipulate that data any longer. You want to do something with it now, like output it to the screen or export onto parameters. And that's where you place a null job. You can name those null jobs. You could say null underscore angles or something. You don't need to use an underscore. You can also use this camel case here. But this kind of gives you an information now as well what this data is for. And now we want to get this onto these parameters here. So let's select the circle one top. And well, now we somehow need to get this TX value onto this first 120. And to do this, and this is something that needs some practice or repetitive practice to just, it becomes muscle memory essentially. You can click, so have circle one selected, then click the viewer active flag of this operator so that the frame is gone. And now when you roll over those channels, the channels light up green. And what this means is you can grab this channel, so left mouse button click onto the channel, and drag it onto this parameter. Okay, let's repeat this. So you have the null top, but select the circle top first. And then hit the viewer active. And then drag that channel onto arc angles. And then choose export shop. And now you're controlling the this parameter here. And the same with circle two. Yeah, just the opposite parameter. So for circle two, select circle two, grab the TY channel, and export it onto the second angle parameter, export shop. Does that make sense? Yeah. This is a base principle in TouchDesigner. This is how you animate all of this stuff by default. And this is kind of this idea of having a wire also to take it from one to the other. And you can control any of these parameters with that method. All of these parameters can be exported to. So be it color, be it position, be it resolution. It can be all controlled via exporting. I probably should mention that right now, because otherwise I'll forget. And you don't have to follow me here, but if you take this TX and drop it, I'm just going to drop it onto this border width parameter and not choose export shop, but I'll choose relative shop reference.
Sorry.
Right, so if you have these symbols on it.
Un símbolo de exclamación.
Oh, is there a mouse? I think the mouse is off. See. This might be, you might have set the resolution to 1920 by 1080.
Maybe not.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, I'll show that to everyone.
Thank you.
So I'll just yes, that's a good point. Disable key. Oh, damn it. Right. Alright, so I just downgraded my license, so I have also the non-commercial license. That's easier to show here now. So yes, there's a limitation. Our non-commercial licenses have a limitation of for the tops to be 1280 by 720. It doesn't mean that you can still output that onto HD or whatever, but it renders only at that resolution.
Okay.
Yeah, the texture is limited.
Now it's
1280 by 720, yeah, but you could scale it up essentially. And so if I change this here to 1920 by 1080, I get a little yellow warning sign. And if you don't know what the warning, or you see that, to get information about this is the middle mouse button on the node. Or if you don't have a middle mouse button, you can click the eye in the parameters. And the eye in the parameters will tell you about the warning or an error. If there's a red circle with an X, then that would be an error. And you can learn what's happening there. Now, what happened to my circle? Oh, right, border widths. Right, I was doing this. Sorry, I'm just going to repeat this. So what I did was I wanted to show you another way of controlling parameters, which is when you don't choose export chop, but you choose relative chop reference or chop reference, something like that. What's happening is that the parameter is not turning green, but it's turning this light blue. And what this indicates is that there is an expression behind it. There's a Python expression now being used to pull the data in. So to look at this expression, if you want to see how this works, is you can click on the parameter name, or there's a little plus then as well. And what you see is this that we have a tri-state parameter, essentially. And this one is now in expression mode. And this is the Python expression to grab the value from the chop called null angles and the channel TY. There's a benefit of doing that instead of exporting. For example, I just could do times 0.5. I cannot do this with an export. An export is pretty fixed. But here with Python, I can then quickly change stuff around. So there's good use for that. But it's will not deal too much with it. Maybe just as a note also, why is this a tri-state? It means that I can switch over into constant mode, and it will now not be controlled by this expression, and I can like set something manually. But if I click on the expression again, I can reactivate it. So you can switch out of expression or export mode into constant mode, move it a little bit around to see what's happening there, and then go back to what you had before. So I'm just going to delete this again. And I have that. Good. So we pretty much, that's very nice. We're very well on our way with our little installation here. Now, how can I combine those two operators together? Combining operators can be done by compositing. So we have a variety of different composite operators. So let's right click onto the output of the circle one and find, what did I use? Let me just look that up. Oh yeah, let's use an add top. So when you click an add top, it should connect the first input automatically because used right mouse click here, but it comes up with an error, and you can middle mouse click or use the eye with the add top selected. You can use the eye or the middle mouse click to see what the error is. It says not enough sources specified. You're trying to add two things together, so you need to connect the second input, and that gets you those composited on top of each other. And now, this is kind of a weird thing. Let's change the radius of the second circle to something smaller. Let's make the second circle much smaller, let's say a radius of 100 by 100. If you select the second circle, just change the radius. 100 by 100 or anything you like. If you don't have pixels selected there, you could, if you're working in a fraction or aspect ratio, it would be something different. But one difference perhaps from what we did, what we have here, is that this movement is very smooth, while the other movement is quite harsh. Like here, it's a very smooth movement, as you can see when I move my mouse. And here it's very harsh. So we need the way to kind of making this a little bit softer. And there's a good reason why we added this null chop here. Now we're exporting from this null chop, and we want to do something with this data before exporting it. So the null chop gives us the opportunity to insert more operations now before the place where we exported it. Just to prove that point, I'm just going to remove my null. You don't have to follow me here. But this is actually, just follow me along here. So I have my mass chop here. And I have my exports, for example, from this mass chop. But now I would like to filter these values. I want to make them smoother. I would try here, put a filter here. And now the problem is, I have to somehow unexport first. So I have to go here to the circle, right click onto the parameter that I'm exporting to. Say remove export, do the same thing on this one, remove export, lots of work, then export again from the filter. And you might be doing this a couple of times. Now, if you have a null chop here and you export from this null chop, then now what I can do is I can just move these two nodes a little bit to the side. Right click on the output of the mass, add a filter, or perhaps add a lag. Let's add a lag chop. It's a lag chop. LAG, yeah. Yeah. And the
the lag basically allows me to control the up, filtering it up and filtering it down separately. So I'm just going to make this a really big lag in up and down by entering 1 second. And now I have a much smoother movement here.
How did you know how much to add silence?
Yeah. Yeah, it's literally a lot of these things are just trial and error. If you want to compare what's happening here with our mouse data coming in and the lag, there's a very nice operator for that to visualize the difference between the two, which is called the trail chop. So let's have a look at the trail chop. If you hit tab and find the trail, it's in the last column. Trail. And the trail has multiple inputs. So you can connect, for example, the math one to the first input. And you see what it does, it just kind of records over a certain window length that you specify. It records the movement of your mouse here. You can visualize the data of it. And you can connect the lag into the second input. And it adds two more channels, and I'm just going to zoom in a little bit to see what's actually happening. And now you see what the lag is doing. It's smoothing out the, all the. So the lag chop is great to understand if you have a filter, for example, you want to see how that filter behavior is. It's perfect use for that. Or if you need to see jitteriness in an input signal, things like that. That's where the trail comes into a, talking about the trail. That's where the trail comes into place. So this whole thing looks certainly a little bit different than what I've built. Let's have a look what I did. What I actually did is I controlled both of these angles with just the TX value. So yeah. Let's do that.
Yeah.
So how can we, I exported TX to circle 1 and TY to circle 2. To remove an export from the from a parameter, I can go to the parameter, right click on it, and I get the little pop-up menu, and then I can choose remove export, which will delete the export from that parameter. And now I can repeat what I did before, activate the viewer of the null one with the circle two selected, and drag the TX instead of the TY, drag the TX on the second parameter. Circle one has it on the first TX for both. Yeah. So that's good. The next thing what I did with this whole thing was I added an RGB delay. And while we'll look in a bit how to build an RGB delay, you can find some stuff in the palette. As I said, like there are some image filters that we added, so you don't have to build it out every time yourself. So in the palette, click on image filters and find the RGB delay. It's actually RGBA delay, but. And then you drag it just where you want to place it. And it has an input and an output. And if you connect now the output of the add onto the input of the RGB delay,
You get an RGB delay.
This palette dagger, so you want like
hosting? Yeah, so we have, it's not, it's something that we put into the software actually, so it comes, it's not updated online. Okay. It's with each release.
Not, create a new one, put that one.
Yeah, you cannot, you can create your own palette, but only on your computer. Okay. It's not online. Yeah. Does everybody have the RGB delay there? Yeah. The RGB delay is kind of nice because it's a very, it's looks nice. If you go into here, actually, yeah, it's actually, it's overcomplicated in here. We'll build it easier in a second. I think that's... All right, okay. RGB and then that. Good. So I just had to check what else I did. I'm not following my notes necessarily. The TY of the mouse, I used to rotate the whole composition. So we added the two circle parts together, and then I used the TY to rotate now the whole thing, like both circles together. And how can that be done? The rotation, a rotation of both things together can be done with a transform top. So if we right click on the output of the add top and find the transform top, transform, it's the last column right at the top. Then there you have basic transform parameters, translating it, scaling it, you have rotation. And this rotation we can connect to the to TY.
Of the null.
From the null, yeah. And we'll export it, yeah. So activate the viewer again from the null and grab the TY channel. And with the transform top selected, that's one of the things you should always have the operator selected so that the parameters are there. You can drag the TY onto the rotate. And now you have this very similar behavior as I had it in my example file. Now, there is often the case that you have to, that you forget to select the operator with the parameters that you want to export to, and that's kind of annoying. Like you want to, you're ready to export, you basically have the channel, and then you realize it's the wrong parameters. A shortcut, what you can do is you grab the channel, and then you hover over the node that you want to export to. And you see how the parameters are changing. So you grab that, you can grab the channel and hover over the node that you want to export to, and the parameters are changing to it. Then you can even change the pages by hovering over the page, so you can navigate that as well. Yeah. And if you let go, well, let's select the circle. Let's just do that again. So I'll move over the transform. And I want to export here, but then I see, oh, it's already exported actually. So I go back. The selection goes back to the previously selected node. So it's a shortcut basically for exporting to places. Well, in the last step in our, I did one more thing actually. I did the circle 2, I turned on the polygon parameter just to make it look a little bit different. Make it look like, yeah, like that. You can get a little bit more variants. So turn on polygon, and you can choose a site, like how many ever edges you think your circle should have. And the last step was to put the grids into the background, the single black white lines. And I did that with the in the palette in the generator section. There is a component called checker. So let's drag this checker onto our pane. So it's in the palette under generators checker. And all the checker does is it creates, you can basically create a checker pattern. Can I actually use that? I did. Oh, right. Okay. Yeah. Sorry, I just had to check. Oh, right. Yeah. Saving. Saving is always a good idea. It's amazing. I've been working with this software since 2002 or 2003 or something like that. And it's still, I don't save. And it crashes. There's sometimes crashes.
Yeah.
There's an autosave. There's a component in tools that's an autosave, but you need to remember to remove that from when you're.
Otherwise, it will be your bad.
Or it's more when you then at a performance or something like that, and you hit save. The saving process can take, depending on your patch, it can take a bit. So then it's kind of
your life.
Yeah, it's saving. We'll be back in 5 minutes.
Yeah.
So right, with this checker here, let's just set the vertical divisions to something like 60. So we have a nice amount of lines. And let's change the resolution parameter here from 1280 by 720 to 1 by 720. So we just have a single row of checkerboard here. Or not like black and white lines, basically. Now we can still composite these two together. And let's choose a different composite method. While we chose an add here, let's try out the composite top. The composite top is a little bit different. So I'll right-click on the output of the checker and find the composite. Whoops. Sorry. Find the composite top. Right here. And the composite top now also has an error. Middle mouse clicking on it will tell it has not enough sources specified. But there's a distinct difference between the composite and the add. It's that this one looks like it only has one input, and the add has two inputs. But if you look closely, then these other nodes with one input have a very small like notch to plug in the other one, while this one has a bigger one. And what this indicates is that you can connect as many other operators to it as you want. There's, I think there is a limit, but I believe the limit is at something like 9,999. So there should be enough room. So you can take the output of the RGBA delay and attach it to the same input, essentially. It's just a multi-input, giving you the possibility to just keep adding stuff together. And one thing that I hadn't mentioned before, two things as I see right now. If I grab this, like I left click onto the output of an operator, and now the wire is attached to my mouse. If I go close to a input that accepts that wire, it kind of gets magnetic, and I can do that. Just as an example, I'm gonna take a mask chop here, and just to prove a concept here, red and blue and green operators usually don't mix very well. If I take the output from the RGBA delay and I try to connect it to the input of the math, it basically closes up, indicating that this is not a valid connection to be made.
Okay.
Because textures and chops don't mix. I would have to convert the texture into chops first, and then I could work with it. But okay, so we have our composite top, and the difference with the composite top is that it allows me in the parameters when you check it, it has this whole slew of composite operations, which includes most of the ones that you're probably familiar with from Photoshop. And here we can choose something. Let's see, what did I use? I mean, you could just pick any. I chose heat for edit. And that is essentially already, I think that's pretty much what the other thing had, like what I wanted to build here. But the composite top, perhaps you see how it's slightly going gray into each direction. Now imagine you're taking this one pixel line and you're placing it onto the big 1280 by 720 canvas, and then you stretch it across. It's going to bevel, like it bevels to the side, basically. It fades out to the side. But we can change that. We can, if you go on the composite top onto the transform page, and this is an interesting, these two parameters are very, very interesting. They basically deal with how you combine different resolution operators. So if you have a 256 by 256 text, and you want to place that text onto 1280 by 720, you don't want that text to stretch. You don't want what's happening here, that it's filling the whole canvas. What you would want in that instance, you want to change the prefit overlay from fill to native resolution, for example. Now, native resolution just takes the one line and puts it on top of the other, or composite in some way, and you don't end up with much. You can also choose fit horizontal. What is that actually? What fit horizontal? Why does it do that? Fit. Oh, yes. Yes, fit horizontal, of course. It takes the whole texture and scales it up until it fits horizontally. So it takes my one pixel line and it scales it aspect correct. And what I end up is one little, like a white and a black pixel, most likely. You can fit it vertically, which again would be just the one single pixel. Fit best is the fitting it inside. Fit outside is again the fill horizontal, fit horizontal in that case. What we choose is fill here because we get a little bit of the gray.
Sorry, I changed the order of the connection.
Yeah.
And the links mainly. Yes, and the result was different.
Yeah.
It's an order of priority.
Yeah, and that's exactly the second parameter here. So you can change the input of these multi-input. You have these multi-input operators, and they have this input op list here in the bottom, where you can reorder them. Literally, when you click on this arrow, it reorders them. But this is an interesting point here, because we have, let's say this is actually, we have the circle as the first input and the grid as the second input, but that's not necessarily what we want. We can fix that by changing the fixed layer. The fixed layer is the layer where it takes its resolution from. So if you change the fixed layer to No. Go away.
No, no!
Luckily, that didn't happen on Saturday, so I'm happy. And I even have quiet hours on. Like, what else can I do? Anyway. So the fixed layer kind of takes, it determines from which input to take the resolution and from which input then to act on with all these translate scale and all these parameters down here. So right now, having chosen input 2 as my fixed layer, which is the default, it takes the 1x720 resolution here from the checker. If I change this to input 1, I've got again the original resolution. Now, a lot of these composite operations very much depend on the order of the inputs.
Okay.
And for that, there's also a swap input toggle here, where you can swap the operation order as well. So you can basically any, if they're connected and you want to see a subtract, but the other way around, then you can swap the operation order here. Again, that's also a parameter that can be exported to. So you can control this from a MIDI thing or whatever.
There's a kind of blend mode to this.
Between the two, you could. I mean, depending how you would want to blend, you could either attach a level top to it and control the opacity or something like that.
Not there, but you have to put for.
Yeah, it's another operation again. Or if you have two different, let's say I have two different composites here, one with heat and one with difference, then if you want to blend between those two, then there's a crosstop. It's another filter. It's called the cross. And the cross lets you blend between two inputs.
It's like a mixer.
It's a mixer, yeah. It's called the cross. It's a top, yeah. Also a texture operator. Right. And if two inputs is not enough, then there is the switch. Now, the switch top switches between two inputs. It basically flips, or not two, it switches between as many. But it has an option to blend between inputs. So if you turn blend between inputs on, now it does essentially the same thing as the cross, but across many tops. It depends on what you
You have a lot
there's many ways to deal with these. Often you maybe have an AD bank where you go between two, and then you could use another top that's called the select top. Where is it? I don't see it. I'm blind here. So I have select A and select B, and I might have now 10 of these different looks that I want to, and then I could just assign to my different banks the operator that I want to mix in, and then just have a cross between the two or something like that. Yeah.
Sorry, you can put one parameter, one slider out of the windows to control, to set your own...
Tell
me.
I think I understand the... there is something in what components and not sure we're going to be able to look at that necessarily, but components have something called custom parameters.
Okay.
And
okay.
This here, the checker, this is a component that we build and put into the palette. But we, you can put custom parameters onto these components, making
yes,
controlling, like you just open up the parameters that you basically want to control.
Okay.
Or the for the user to control. Similar, the RGBA delay here has control over the size of the red, green, blue delay. So I could make it a red, green, blue, could make it really, really tiny.
Okay.
One frame offset for red, one for two for green, three for blue. So these parameters are custom ones. And I'll just tell you where to add them is basically right clicking onto a component and then customize component will open up an editor where you can control these create pages, create parameters, and then using a parameter chop, it's called the parameter chop, you can get access to those to export them. So yeah, but for what we want to do, we have our installation almost ready, so put a null onto the end of the whole thing. A null, null top. And I mentioned that earlier when we looked at comps for components, that there's a window component, which we would use to output it to the screen. So let's place a window component here. So I hit tab, and I go to the component family, it's the first one. And in the third section here, there's the window component. And I place that. Now the window component is quite extensive, but we'll go across the most important parts of it. And then you, the rest is kind of self-explanatory to the most part. So the window component is literally your output, the output window that will be created. It needs to know what operator you want to output onto the screen. And so you can drag this null top that we just created. You can drag that onto the operator parameter. The comp, yeah. Works as well.
Okay. So what do we do now?
So I would put a null there because I might wanna put an HSV adjust.
Okay.
I decide that I wanna put something in there later.
Okay.
And then it's always good to have the null. Yeah, that's your output, and you can do in the in between, you can do whatever you want. Yeah, it's literally just clean, yeah, clean cleanliness. And it's very, if that becomes kind of the thing you do always, always putting a null at the end, then it's very, you will be very happy about it.
When you come back, you say, oh, I should.
So with this operator in the, with this null specified in the operator, we can already try at the bottom of the parameters. You can find a lot of buttons here. And one of them, let's try that. It's called open a separate window. If you click on that button, it opens up a little window. And this window now has a couple of things that I don't like. It's got or just finish the window, because then a break would be perfect. Yeah. Right, yeah. But that would end the lesson. Like this part. So I click the in the parameters at the bottom, you can find the open a separate window button. And if this parameter window is too long, you can scroll down on the parameter window. And what it does is it opens up a window, but this window has a title bar, it has borders, it's not the right size of your monitor. So we have to somehow set this all up. And we will just go through these parameters and then break once we have a full screen image here. So let's close this window again and let's check these parameters. We can opening size. The opening size current.
Sorry, I'm stuck in the window.
Escape. Escape key. Perfect. So we have the opening size, which is currently derived off the top resolution. So it's going to be 1280 by 720. And you want to change this to fill your monitor. Or custom if you want to specify. Then we can turn off borders. Borders turned off. And now we can already, if we now click open as a separate window, it should open up full screen. So now escape closes the whole thing. And I just mentioned this so you know, there is parameters here which are a little bit dangerous. Close on escape key, you can turn that off. If you turn it off, then nobody gets into your, or it's harder to get into your network. But yeah, you're kind of locked out. No, the idea for that is literally to prevent interaction, like from people of exiting out of it. And you can script your way out, but the best thing is then control alt delete or something. So this is should be used with should be sure about that this is what you want to do. And the other thing I should mention is there's a difference here. If I open up this window as a separate window, as we clicked here, what happens is that in the background, we still have our project. It's still, the network is still rendering. It's still calculating. And this can be a performance drag because you're rendering the whole network plus the output screen. To prevent this, you can open up this window as a perform window. There's a button, open as perform window. And now there's the one you see here, the Touch Designer is the my example network. But now you only have the output being rendered. The network is kind of shut down and you gain quite a bit of performance for like things or installation work, etc. And escape gets you out of that. There is one more shortcut to this. There's down here, there's a parameter called set as perform window. If you click on this once, you just set as perform window. And now you can hit F1. And F1 will take you right into this perform mode. So it's a shortcut essentially. There's more. There's always on top. If you want to prevent any other windows to pop on top, you can hide the cursor if you want to, which is useful for ending up with your cursor on the screen, etc. So quite a bit of options. Some of them are self-explanatory. Others might need a little bit digging in the documentation. But this would be a good time to break because we finished the first step. Control save. Save. All right.
So we're not done yet.